Okay, so welcome to Grace Lutheran Church. I'm a rookie, so be patient with me here. Today we're having communion, and so Jesus invites us all to come to his meal and be persuaded by his promise that when we eat this bread and drink his wine, by faith we receive Jesus' true body and blood and for the forgiveness of our sins. If this is your faith and conviction, and you understand and believe that Jesus truly is present in, with, and under the bread and the wine, then come to the altar and receive Jesus and his promise to forgive. If you are not sure of this teaching at this time, to receive the bread and wine, but wish to receive prayer blessing, then Jesus also invites you to come forward. Simply cross your hands and over your heart and receive a blessing. And so, please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God the Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And you may be seated.
Oh, Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O God, the source of all that is just and good,
nourish in us every virtue, and bring to completion every good intent,
that we may grow in grace, and bring forth the fruit of good works, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord,
who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit,
one God, now and forever. Amen. And now we have a children's message. I guess you can sit for that.
It's been a great week. On Thursday, we finished the Bible study, A Jesus-Shaped Life, on us learning to be disciples. And we're still just learning. We realize how much more we have to learn. And then just on Friday, Keaton came home from his summer job. He said that he will think about promising me to never, ever leave again. He said he's thinking about it. So it's amazing. Yesterday, I just about didn't make it here because just how busy it was. They said, you need to work tomorrow. You are mandated to come to work. You have no choice. You have to come to work. Just before the shift ended, I was just actually had my shoes on to go home. They said someone else, they were able to move people around, or someone else who they didn't know about had already said they would work. So I must be here for a reason. Just as Carolyn's song, I was a little defeated coming home, but then read Ephesians 6, to be strong in the Lord and in his great power. So I began thinking about the armor of God. And, you know, as we recently have seen, the Edmonton Elks who wear their helmet to protect them, we must also put on our armor of God. But our armor is a little bit different. We're on the team. We're our team. Jesus is the coach, or the captain, as the song says. He's the captain of our team. And the other addition, the goal of our team is to do everything we can to help other people decide to be on Jesus' team. Our goal is to get everybody on our team. We're not just a team that you have to be proficient at one thing. We want everybody on our team. We have no way of knowing. The Elks have no way of knowing who's going to win. But one thing about our team, we know we're already won. The Bible promises us that Christians will win the very important game or battle between good and evil. If I don't know about you, but I want to be on that team. Just sort of as an aside, you know, when we're putting on our armor, one of our armor is the Bible. And has anyone ever, mostly ladies, played a game that what's in your purse? And then whoever has the most things in their purse wins the game, or wins the door prize, hey? Well, I just lost my page, but this one is about what's in your Bible. What do you put in your Bible? So as the story I had, it said that the pastor had come to the house and they couldn't find the Bible. And finally they found the Bible, and when they opened it, the gentleman's glasses fell out. And he said, "There's my glasses." And then they found a tuft of hair from their little granddaughter. And then they found a list of everybody's birthday. And as you notice my Bible, it even has stains of coffee that I spilt on it many times. But I have some bulletins, some crosses. But you know, one thing about the Bible is we're not to put things in it. We are to take things out. All those promises that are written for us, that help us, all the armor of God, are written in here. We are to take them out and use them. So don't use your Bible to put things in. Not that it's bad to put. I have all these crosses and things to remind you where you want to read. But take things out of your Bible, not put things in. Thank you.
Deuteronomy 4:1-2 and 6-9. Now, O Israel, listen to the statutes and the just decrees that I am teaching you, and do them, that you may live and go in and take possession of the land that the Lord, the God of your fathers, is giving you. You shall not add to the word that I command you, nor take from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you. Keep them and do them, for that will be your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the peoples, who, when they hear all these statutes, will say, "Surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. For what great nation is there that has a God so near to it as the Lord our God is to us, whenever we call upon him? And what great nation is there that has statutes and just decrees so righteous as all this law that I set before you today? Only take care and keep your soul diligently, lest you forget the things that your eyes have seen, and lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and to your children's children." This is the word of the Lord. Ephesians 6:10-20. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 119, 129-136. Your testimonies are wonderful, therefore my soul keeps them. The unfolding of your words gives light. It imparts understanding to the simple. I open my mouth and pant because I long for your commandments. Turn to me and be gracious to me, as is your way with those who love your name. Keep steady my steps according to your promise, and let no iniquity get dominion over me. Redeem me from man's oppression, that I may keep your precepts. Make your face shine upon your servant, and teach me your statutes. My eyes shed streams of tears, because people do not keep your law. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Is it up there? Okay.
You've got it.
Okay. Mark 7:14-23. Please stand for the gospel. Jesus called the people to him again and said to them, "Hear me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going into him can defile him, but the things that come out of a person are what defiles him." And when he had entered the house and left the people, his disciples asked him about the parable, and he said to them, Then are you also without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into a person from the outside cannot defile him, since it enters not his heart, but stomach, and is expelled? Thus he declared all foods clean. And he said, what comes out of a person is what defiles him. For from within, out of the heart of a man, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these things come from within, and they defile a person. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And everyone, now you can sit
seated
again. Thank you.
And you could put that on. It's wonderful to divert from the script sometimes, isn't it? We certainly have. The devil is alive and active, and the sermon today is about second thoughts on the way home from the devil's funeral. Ephesians 6:10-13. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his might. Put on the whole armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, authorities, and powers of this dark world. There's a problem with apathy in the world today. It's sort of like we all went to the devil's funeral and we decided to stay for coffee. We buried the devil and we came to believe he was really dead and will probably stay dead. So we had coffee. But as we walk home from the funeral, some very unsettling thoughts begin to strike us. Who was in the coffin? The coffin was never really opened, was it? And why did the devil's friends take his death so easily? The family of the devil are never given to defeat very easily. They usually howl and gnash their teeth and lash out against defeat. Is he really dead? Hmm. on our way home, St. Paul is a good man to meet because he didn't ever attend the devil's funeral. He was too realistic for that. He knows the devil is not dead. He knows that Satan is very much alive and on the prowl. St. Paul knows that the battle with Satan is inevitable, and he knows what the battle is like. He knows that the battle is tricky, the battle is lonely, and the battle can be won. The battle is tricky. Let's look at that. Take your stand against the devil's schemes. Satan is a lot more sophisticated than we are. He has lived longer than we have. And he knows the human race very closely. And he's lived with the human race for many, many years. And he has a lot of hatred for all these centuries because of the human race. And the one thing certain about his modus operandi is that he will not use the expected weapons, the weapons that we expect him to use. The devil is a terrorist when it comes to fighting against the people of God. A terrorist. His attack will be in the most unlikely ways and in the most unlikely places. Sometimes Satan will use a strategy of tolerance. He teaches us that we have our faith, but we should not stand up for our beliefs because others have their faith too. And so we should be tolerant of their beliefs. Well, the problem is that's not what the Bible teaches us. The Bible teaches us that we need to be loving and patient with people. With people. But never tolerant with evil. Love the sinner, but hate the sin. Stand up against the sin. We need to be tolerant with people, but we also need to be intolerant with the evil that people do. Another strategy of Satan is this self-defeating strategy of frustration. Satan's strategy tells us, hey, you tried to do your best. You tried to do what was right and good and just, but look at how it's all turned out. So what's the use? Nothing helps, no one cares. Why should you? You tried your best, just, you can give up. You've tried to do what's good. And Satan smiles as we shed a sad or a bitter tear and throw in the towel. He smiles. Negativity and giving up, is it a tool of God or is it a tool of Satan? Another strategy of Satan is a strategy of weariness or self-pity. The devil is not dead, but very much alive and makes us feel good about our self-pity. You're tired of trying. And Satan can make you feel awful noble about your tiredness. That's why sloth is called one of the seven deadly sins. It's Satan's temptation to laziness, melancholy, and resignation that can trap you in its dark cave and cause you to even loathe life itself. This is not God's doing. This is the work of the enemy. The enemy who's alive and well. The funeral for Satan was a sham. Another dark, perverted tool of Satan is the tool of misplaced priorities. The tyranny of the urgent. There's always something else that we feel that we have to do first. Maybe we'll get around to doing the work of God, but these are things we got to do first. These are not important things, but they seem to be pressing. And sometimes these pressing things take away all of our time and our vital energy from doing the works of God. The worst satanic strategy that the devil uses to destroy us is that he uses tools that are so personal to us. He always attacks us with weapons that we have furnished, that we have formed, that we have forged. He doesn't use his own tools. He uses our tools of destruction. Maybe somehow in life there might have been an essay contest, and we've written our little essays for Satan. I like sinning because. And what he has done is he's used those small little essays against us. When we look into the face of adversity, we see our own future, our own features, and we see our own ideas, and we see our own suggestions, and he uses our tools against us. Satan is not dead. He's very much alive. He knows how to use all of our mistakes and all of our foibles and all of our faults and all of our flaws against us. Who will deliver us from this evil? We know. The Lord. But we have to turn to him. And we have to realize that he is stronger even than Satan. We need to recognize that this battle with Satan, secondly, is a very lonely battle. St. Paul says that we struggle or wrestle against powers and rulers and spiritual forces of another world. It would be easier if we were fighting against things and people we know, but we're fighting alone. By ourselves, wrestling with another world, in another world with the prince of darkness and loneliness. And the worst battles in life are always the ones we wage alone. The worst kind of prison is solitary confinement. And Satan knows how to wage this kind of battle with us where we feel alone. All alone. I remember years ago visiting a man in the Royal Alex Hospital in Edmonton, asking him what brought him to the hospital. Well, it was alcoholism. And here he was after falling off the wagon in a very critical way, and he was trying to start over, setting new goals and priorities for his life. And he realized his goal was to get back to attending AA. and spending time with his sponsor and the people who could support him and would support him and help him. He needed to get out of the hospital bed and get to others who could help. He talked about how important it was for him to get back to AA and to his Lutheran church in Vegreville, and to those who would hold him accountable and help him. And I spent time with him, putting him back into the presence of God and helping him to realize once again that he was a child of God, just as you and I are children of God. Let's never forget that. We are so precious to God, and God doesn't want any one of us to fight the battles of life alone. So where can we find help in this lonely battle? Scripture says, in prayer, in community with other people who care, and with God, who says, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you, I'm with you to the end of the world. This is a very tricky battle. This is a very lonely battle against Satan, but it is one that can be won. W-O-N. We can win this battle. No, God can win this battle. Sometimes we forget that we have a connection and a relationship with the strongest and most personal, powerful force in the world. I call him God and Son Unlimited. Unlimited. Our God is an awesome God. He has the power to defeat evil and sin in the world. And when it comes to God and his power, you got to know when to hold him. And when it comes to the things and work of Satan, you got to know when to fold him. We have to be willing to put on off the clothes of our sinful mortality and put on the winning armor of God. The belt of truth. Truth is needed so much today in relationships and lives. The breastplate of Jesus' righteousness, not I, me, my righteousness, but his breastplate. The shoes of the gospel, so we can walk and talk and share in pleasant places. The protective helmet of God's salvation, thinking God thoughts, not my thoughts. And the sword of God's holy word to cut away all these mistaken thoughts and ideas that we might have. God gives us what we need for this battle with evil, this battle with Satan, who is not dead, but very much fightingly alive. The real battle of life that's going on around us is tricky, is lonely. But if we allow God to clothe us with his armor, this battle can be won. So scripture says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take the stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but our struggle is against the rulers, the authorities, and the powers of this dark age. the armor of God, the gifts of God for the people of God, why would we not take up the armor of God? May the peace of Jesus Christ, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds on the gospel of our Lord. Amen. Would you all please rise as we say together the Nicene Creed? I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated for the prayers. Let us pray. We praise you, O God, in all of our circumstances. We trust your goodness, and we know that whether we see it or not, you are there to help us and guide us, and you will assure us that all things work together for good to those who love you. We know we fight against the devil's temptations every day. The battle is tricky, the battle is lonely, but the battle can be won. Help us to keep our eyes on Jesus so we do not fall prey to Satan. Help us to see your power and speak to you daily in prayer. Lord, in your mercy. Thank you for a country where we can celebrate the blessings of having jobs. Thank you for employers who show care through appropriate working conditions and wages that enable us to be one of the most privileged countries in the world. We thank you, Lord, for all these wonderful blessings. Lord, in your mercy. Bless our family members who go back to school this week and continue their studies to prepare for future endeavors. Help all of us to engage in lifelong learning so that we may do your will and be beacons of faith in our fragmented society. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for members of our congregations, communities, and friends who are hospitalized, sick, or infirm. We pray for Matthew, who's going to have some surgery this week. We pray for all those in this congregation who are suffering with disabilities that they need your help with. Be their source of healing and their strength for their bodily weakness. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for this congregation. We are your children, your family of faith in this place. Let this be a place of rest and restoration and renewal, as care is given and love is shown to all who come to this church to refresh their lives and their souls. Send Grace Congregation a resident pastor who will guide all of the programs here of outreach and evangelism and spiritual growth and prayer. This congregation needs a full-time shepherd who leads and cares. Help supply this need. Lord, in your mercy. We seek your help in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together confidently, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Would you rise as we prepare for Holy Communion, and as we bring forth the offering?
Because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart.
But I think I'm going to let you guys carry
the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and proper that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord our God, King of all creation. For you have had mercy on us. You've given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this. Eat this. Receive this as my body. Receive the body of the Lord every time you eat this. In the same manner, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the remission of sins. As often as you drink this, do it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Lamb of God, you take away the
So you lead the...
Pardon?
You lead the way.
Okay. We'll do our first, okay? We'll do our first.
Okay.
Okay. You can just give us communion.
Take and eat the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given in death for you.
Through Christ in me. still my lips shall repeat. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Thank you.
Would you all stand for prayer? Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this life-giving gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.